Welcome back, Year Nines. Lesson 17. And the title for this lesson is Juliet is Feeling Desperate. And if you have a little look down in the corner of the slide, we've got a little picture of some sleeping potion there. Recap. Juliet is married to Romeo, but he's banished. Her father has told her that she will marry Paris in 3 days' time. If she refuses, Lord Capulet will disown her and throw her out of their home. So this lesson, we'll see just how desperate Juliet is and what her choices are. Juliet threatens to kill herself if she's forced to marry Paris. There are two levels to that. Firstly, it's a sin to get married twice, but also she truly, truly loves Romeo. Friar Lawrence advises her to take a potion that will make her appear dead. Juliet follows the friar's plan. Juliet is a tragic character. She suffers and she takes action. Right, little do now starter. So grab your pen. Lord Capulet has told Juliet, Thursday is near, lay hand on heart, advise, and you be mine, I'll give you to my friend, and you be not, hang, beg, starve, die in the streets, I'll not be forsworn. So, two questions for you. Number one, what does Lord Capulet want Juliet to do? Number two, why is Juliet unable to do this? So can you jot down your ideas? And that comes from last lesson. And then the extension there is, what would you do if you were Juliet? Would you marry Paris? Have you got any other options? So get your notes down onto your paper there. Just going to repeat the quote again, because this is a very, very important quotation really to show, you know, where Capulet's coming from. Thursday is near, lay hand on heart, advise. And you be mine, I'll give you to my friend. And you be not, hang, beg, starve, die in the streets, I'll not be forsworn. So Lord Capulet wants Juliet to marry Paris. If she refuses, he threatens to kill her. Juliet cannot marry Paris because she is already married to Romeo. It would be a crime and a sin to marry someone else, but she cannot tell her father that she is married to Romeo. So here's the background here. We've got a little map of Italy. Or this part of Italy. The blue little marker there shows Verona, where Juliet is. 30 miles an hour away, we've got Mantua with Romeo. And Juliet doesn't know what to do. She can't ask for help from Romeo because he's so far away. And the only person that she can turn to is Friar Lawrence. Juliet is desperate. She will do anything to avoid being forced to marry Paris. Luckily, Friar Lawrence has got a plan, but it is a very dangerous plan. Today we're going to find out what this plan is. So I'm going to read you through the scene. Now with the slides this lesson, what I've done is I've put the original Shakespearean script on the left-hand side, and I'll be reading those through with you. But on the right-hand side, I've got the modern version. So if you wanted to spend a little bit more time going back over, that might be quite useful. I think. So the modern English is on the right hand side and then Shakespeare is on the left hand side. When we've got to this particular point of the scene, Juliet's gone to Friar Lawrence and she's actually met Paris before she gets to see Friar Lawrence, so she's already had a bit of a discussion with him. At that point, Paris leaves and she's left alone with Friar Lawrence, and Friar Lawrence is aware already that Juliet has to marry Paris. Juliet says, "Oh, shut the door. And once thou hast done so, come weep with me, past hope, past cure, past help." And I've put that in bold there. This is the sort of mental position that Juliet finds herself in. She's incredibly emotional. She feels that there are no options now. She's past hope, past cure. Okay, nobody can help her. Friar Lawrence steps in. "Oh, Juliet, I already know thy grief. It strains me past the compass of my wits. I hear thou must, and nothing may prorogue it. On Thursday next, be married to this county." Now, the county there obviously is Paris. Okay. So Friar Lawrence understands Juliet's situation. We get to this point and we see how Juliet is really incredibly desperate. She says, "Tell me not, Friar, that thou hast heard of this, unless thou tell me how I may prevent it. If in thy wisdom thou canst give no help, do thou but call my resolution wise, and with this knife I'll help it presently. And the stage direction here says, shows him a knife. God joined my heart and Romeo's, thou our hands, and ere this hand by thee to Romeo sealed, shall be the label to another deed, or my true heart with treacherous result turn to another. This shall slay them both. Therefore, out of thy long experienced time, give me some present counsel, or behold, twixt my extremes and me this bloody knife shall play the umpire, arbitrating that which the commission of thy years and art could to no issue of true honour bring. Be not so long to speak, I long to die, if what thou speakst speak not of remedy. And to sum up that little scene there, basically saying, if you don't have a plan, Friar, I will kill myself. And she's got the knife there. She's saying that God has put her and Romeo and Juliet, her and Romeo together. She said that the friar has bound them in marriage. And if they can't find a way forward, she has no option but to kill herself. Friar Laurence comes back and he says to her, hold, daughter, I do spy a kind of hope which craves as desperation and execution. As this desperate, which we would prevent, if rather than to marry County Paris, thou hast the strength of will to slay thyself, then it is likely thou wilt undertake a thing like death to chide away this shame, that copest with death himself to escape from it. And if thou darest, I'll give you a remedy. The plan's going to be dangerous. And if we look down on the more modern version on the right-hand side, I've put this in bold, you can wrestle with death to escape from shame, and if you dare to do it, I will give you a solution. So he realizes her situation. He also realizes that, you know, if she's brave enough or she's desperate enough to commit suicide, then this other plan is actually a real option that they could consider. Juliet responds, this time I'm going to actually read the modern version. I want you to get a real idea of the images that Juliet's putting forward here. She says, oh, you can tell me to jump off the battle posts of any tower, or to walk down the crime-ridden streets of a slum, or tell me to sit in a field full of poisonous snakes, chain me up with wild bears, hide me every night in the morgue full of dead bodies with wet smelly flesh and skulls without jawbones, or tell me to climb down into a freshly dug grave and hide me with the dead man in his tomb. All those ideas make me tremble when I hear them named, but I will do them without fear or dread, in order to be a pure wife to my sweet love. These are very stark images. And you could say that Juliet's going quite over the top, really. These are really foul, foul ideas. But really, she's saying, I'm prepared to put up with this as long as I can be with the person I love more than anything else in the world. Now we get to Friar Laurence's plan, and it's going to be really important that you know the order that Friar Laurence has set things out in. I'm going to read the Shakespeare version, and I'm going to go straight on and read the more modern version. And as I read through, I want you to start thinking about what could possibly go wrong with this plan. Friar Laurence says, hold then, go home, be merry, give consent to marry Paris. Wednesday is tomorrow. Tomorrow night, look, thou lie alone. Let not the nurse lie with thee in thy chamber, shows her a vial. She's got a little glass bottle there. Take this vial, being then in bed, and this distilled liquor drink thou off. Then presently through all thy veins shall run a cold and drowsy humour, for no pulse shall keep his negative progress, but shall cease. No warmth, no breath shall testify thou livest. The roses in thy lips and cheeks shall fade to pallid ashes. Thy eyes, windows fall, like death when he shuts up the day of life. Each part deprived of subtle government shall stiff and stark and cold appear like death. And in this borrowed likeness of shrunk death, thou shalt continue 42 hours and then awake as if from a pleasant sleep. So modern version. Hold on then, go home, be cheerful and tell them that you will agree to marry Paris. Tomorrow is Wednesday. Tomorrow night, make sure that you are alone. Don't let the nurse stay with you in your bedroom, showing her the vial. When you are in bed, take this vial, mix its contents with liquor and drink. Then a cold, sleep-inducing drug will run through your veins and your pulse will stop. Your flesh will be cold and you'll stop breathing. The red in your lips and your cheeks will turn pale, and your eyes will shut. It will seem like you're dead. You won't be able to move, and your body will be stiff like a corpse. You remain in this death-like state for 42 hours, and then you'll wake up as if from a pleasant sleep. So it's quite a terrifying idea that really she's going to appear to be completely dead. This is the next part of the plan. Fry Laurence says that the family will find her dead in the morning and then will plan to put her into the vault, into the tomb where the other Capulets are already buried. So Tybalt will be there. But he's got another plan before they get to that point. Now, when the bridegroom in the morning comes to rouse thee from thy bed, there art thou dead. Then, as manner of our county is, in thy best robes uncovered on the bier, thou shalt be borne to that same ancient vault where all the kindred of the Capulets lie. In the meantime, against thou shalt awake, shall Romeo by my letters know our drift, and hither shall he come. And he and I will watch by thy waking, and that very night shall Romeo bear thee hence to Mantua, and this shall free thee from this pleasant shame, if no inconstant toy nor womanish fear abate thy valour in the acting of it. So the plan is that Romeo will know about the plan, and he will come, and he and the friar will sit and watch Juliet in the vault until she's awake. And then the plan is to take Juliet away to Mantua so that they can be together, if Juliet can carry out this plan. Juliet doesn't need to think about this plan at all. She says, give me, oh, tell not me of fear. Friar Laurence gives her the vial, gives her the glass bottle with the medicine in. Hold, get you gone, be strong and prosperous in this resolve. I'll send a friar with speed to Mantua with my letters to thy lord. Juliet, love give me strength, and strength shall help me afford. Farewell, dear father. And then they leave separately. So Juliet's resolved. She's now got this vial that can make her fall asleep so that everyone believes she's dead. Friar Laurence is going to send some letters with a friar so that Romeo will hear the plan. So far, so good. You might already have spotted some flaws in this plan. Next slide, little activity. So you're going to need a pen and some paper. Here are some images that relate to Friar Laurence's plan. You're going to place the images in the correct order and then use the image to summarise Friar Laurence's plan. So I'm just going to whiz over them. A, we've got the glass vial there. Looks very mysterious with the green medicine-y, liquidy type thing inside. B, we've got two people dashing away. C, we've got time. D, we've got the vault where Juliet will be. E, some kind of sleeping going on there. And F, a letter. So see if you can get those into order, because it's really, really important that you know which order the plan's going to be happening in. Pause if you need to, just to get down the order that you think they should be in. Okay, let's check if you've got the order correct. A, Juliet's going to be taking the potion. She's going to go home tonight and drink the potion. E, the potion will make you appear dead. D, Paris will find you in the morning and everyone will think that you're dead. You'll be buried in the Capulet family tomb. 48 hours. And then you'll be waking up. Romeo and I will wait for you, and then you can flee the city together. F, I will write to Romeo and tell him of our plan. Okay. Desperate times call for desperate measures. This has become such a famous quote, actually. Some people just quote that out of context. The friar's plan is dangerous and it's very risky. At each stage, there is a great danger that the plan will fail. Look at each stage of the friar's plan and work out what are the possible risks and what the dangers could be. Extension. Have a little think about this one as well. Juliet is still prepared to undertake the plan. Juliet's tragic flaw is her passionate love for Romeo. How does this plan foreshadow her tragic end? The first part of the plan, to go home and drink this potion. Juliet might lose the potion, she might bottle it, she might not decide to go through with the plan. A family might discover something that's up. The potion will make you appear dead. Again, we're really depending on that potion is accurate, is going to work like the friar says. Can we trust the friar? The friar's going to be in deep trouble once they find out that he's married Romeo and Juliet in the first place. Maybe this is a way for him to get rid of Juliet. Paris will find you in the morning and everyone will think you're dead. You'll be buried in the Capulet tomb. That seems fairly likely that that would be the next part of the plan there. 42 hours, very specific amount of time, relying on quite a lot of things happening there. Romeo and I will wait for you to wake up and then you can flee the city. Sounds like a simple part of the next plan. We'll find out a bit later. It's not quite as simple as that. I will write to Romeo and tell him of our plan. So that is the friar's plan. And I think we can probably gather it's not going to go quite as he intended it to go. Juliet does follow Friar Lawrence's advice and she drinks the potion. When her lifeless body is discovered, a large funeral is arranged. Nobody knows that she is really alive, except for Friar Lawrence. And of course, her family is devastated. She's 13 years old. They don't know all the ins and outs. This is meant to be her wedding day. It's meant to be a great celebration for the entire family. And then they find that she's dead, in inverted commas. Now do watch this video clip. We've got Juliet's body being taken to the family tomb. I think it's quite a good idea. It gives you quite an idea of what the tomb might be like. You'll see a character nipping in and watching this from a distance. At first, actually, it's easy to think that it might be Romeo, but it's actually Romeo's servant, Balthazar, who's witnessing this. Okay, so have a little think. What is going through Balthazar's mind as he's seeing Juliet being taken to the tomb, and what might be the next thing that he does? Right, hopefully you've got this near at hand. It's the sheet you've been filling out as we've been going through. I know some of my students have done a fabulous job with this. It's the sheet that's got the tragic hero at the top, and hopefully you've filled in quite a few of these boxes already. The tragic end of the play is drawing nearer and nearer. The tragic events and characters of the play are also becoming more evident to the audience. Today we return to the resource and add some more detail. Okay, we've only got three boxes to fill on your sheet, and I've actually given you the first answer anyway. You're going to complete the boxes, go back over the lesson and see if you can find some quotations to fill the boxes. So the first one there, we've got here tragic hero, and of course we've got Romeo on the left hand side and we've got Juliet on the right hand side, and it's Juliet we're following at the moment. So the first box we're going to look at is the tragic hero acts. They try to do things, they don't just let things happen to them. Now, I've given you a little quote there, kind of helped you out a bit. So, this quotation over here on the right-hand side. Give me, oh, tell me not of fear. This is Juliet's response to the friar, and it shows you that she is doing things. She's not stepping back, she's not letting things happening, she's taking action into her own hands. So, pop that quotation straight in there, I've done that one for you. The second box, where actually you're going to have a little look for a quotation. falls under the title, Whatever They Do, It Always Puts Them in a Worse Situation. So, yes, Juliet is act, but she finds herself in a funeral, heading towards her tomb. So that's not a great place to be. So see if you can find a quotation that's going to show you that. And then jumping down to the plot, the green box there, we're going to go down to the rising tension. Obstacle B, Juliet has already been promised to another man. So see if you can go and find a quotation, something that Capulet said or threatened, and you can pop that into that box there as well. So your only task today, for this slide, is to find a little box, little quotation for the second pink box, and then down there for the second obstacle under rising tension. Right, we're heading back to A.C. Bradley. So he's the guy that talked to us first about the nature of tragedy and how Romeo and Juliet linked up with that. He wrote that towards the end of a Shakespearean tragedy, occasionally, where we dread the catastrophe because we love the hero, a moment occurs just before it in which a gleam of false hope lights up the darkening scene. And though we know it is false, it affects us. So here we know that Romeo and Juliet are going to die. We've been told from the very beginning they're going to be dying. There's been lots and lots of foreshadowing all the way through. But here we've got a plan. Friar Lawrence has come up with this plan. And do you know what? It might work. Juliet's brave. She carries it out. So we've just got to get Romeo back from Mantua to save her when she wakes up. Okay, so we can keep our fingers crossed. We're almost holding our breath. Is this going to work? So you're going to write down some ideas for these questions. Number one, how has Shakespeare used foreshadowing in the scene that we have just read? So you might want to take a little bit of time, whiz back over those slides and see if you can find some examples of that. The next question is, what false hope does an audience and Juliet have at this point in the play? Write down a little sentence just to show that you understand what that's asking you there. And number three, what effect does the false hope have on the audience? Why does Shakespeare include it in his plays? He could just have fast-forwarded straight to the end scene. Okay, but he's decided to put this plan in so that we've got something to think about before we get to the end. Now, I've got the final bit of our lesson to get through. I think Mastery is being a little bit unfair to us here. I'm going to take you through the slides and I'm going to go and give you the answers, but I'll say why I think it's a little bit unfair. What examples of foreshadowing are there in Act 4, Scene 1? So if you're not too sure, take a guess. We've got the five answers that I'm going to read through. I'll give you a clue. It's three of them. Juliet takes a potion that makes her appear dead. This foreshadows her real death at the end of the play. Juliet must drink a potion. This foreshadows the way that Romeo will die at the end of the play. C. Juliet says that she will kill herself with a dagger instead of being forced to marry Paris. This foreshadows how she dies at the end of the play. D. Friar Lawrence gives Juliet advice. This foreshadows the way that he married Romeo and Juliet in Act 2, Scene 6. And E. Juliet follows Friar Lawrence's advice. This foreshadows how Lord Capulet is devastated by Juliet's death at the end of the play. Now, as I said, I think the end of this lesson is a little bit unfair. So the question was, what examples of foreshadowing are there in Act 4, Scene 1? A. Give yourself a tick if you got that. Juliet takes a potion that makes her appear dead. This foreshadows her real death at the end of the play. I think that one you can work out. The next two I think are a bit unfair. B. Juliet must drink a potion. This foreshadows the way Romeo will die at the end of the play. But we don't know that at the start. We know he dies, but we don't know how he dies. So unless you actually know the ending of the play, I don't think you can guess that really. Same with C. Juliet says that she will kill herself with a dagger instead of being forced to marry Paris. This foreshadows how she dies at the end of the play. Again, we've been told that she will die at the end, but we haven't told how she does it. So I think you kind of need to have knowledge of the play. So give yourself ticks if you knew that, and give yourself a tick anyway, because I think that's a little bit hard. I'll just whiz over the last two. Friar Lawrence gives Juliet advice. This foreshadows the way that he married Romeo and Juliet. You can't foreshadow something that's already gone past. So that doesn't make much sense. And E, Juliet follows Friar Lawrence's advice. This foreshadows how Lord Capulet is devastated by Juliet's death at the end of the play. That doesn't really link with what we've been saying. Right, thank you ever so much, Year 9. And that's the end of today's lesson. Thank you.